Okay, have a seat. We're going to start. One hour, is it enough for you?
We'll do our best.
Okay, thank you very much. And if you can leave some time to the audience, they can have some questions to interact with you, it should be nice. Thank you very much. The floor is yours.
Good morning, or good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm on a time zone challenge here. It's a great pleasure to be here to moderate this. My name is Jane Ebinger, Director of Policy at Sustainable Energy for All. Sustainable Energy for All is working with many of the leaders on this panel to help them broker the partnerships and unlock the finance for sustainable energy. One important thing here, we're talking about a clean energy transition. It has the potential to offer a historic opportunity for growth and development. It's happening right now, and it's happening around the globe. With the Paris Agreement entering into force, it's heralded an economic transition that must move us by mid-century towards zero net emissions and a world that is more equitable for all. This requires the energy transition to be just. And last year in 2015, we agreed the Sustainable Development Goals. Goal 7, one of these goals, calls for us to secure affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all by 2030. That includes the 1.1 billion people globally that have no access to electrification and the nearly 2.9 billion that lack access to clean cooking solutions. Among those, 700 Africans lack access to electrification today, and that's critically important for development going forward. So to meet the Sustainable Development Goals in the context of Paris, it's important that we have an energy transition that helps us drive this economic transition. This means that the energy transition is going to have to rapidly scale up energy productivity. We're going to need a new generation of institutions to manage our energy systems. We're going to need to think differently about energy services from a centralized and decentralized perspective, and we're going to have to scale up the volume of renewables in the global energy mix. It's technically feasible. What we hear today is to talk about how do we finance that. And I'm very pleased to say we have a distinguished panel with us here today that are going to offer both an African perspective as well as talk about some of the global experience and the implications for Africa. What we're going to talk about is the financing challenges and how we accelerate finance flows at the scale that this transition demands. So without more ado, given that we have a short time and we have a very strong panel, I'd like to welcome them and introduce them here. Working from my left, we have Dorsuma Alhamdu from the African Development Bank. He leads energy efficiency in the Presidential Task Force on the New Deal for Energy for Africa. We have Shigeru Sugiyama, Deputy Director General, Industrial Development and Public Policy in JICA's Tokyo head office. We have Andrew Pidden. Andrew is the Managing Director, Head of Sustainable Investments, Deutsche Bank, and member of Deutsche's Asset Management Alternative Executive Committee. We have Yusuf Ruisi, Deputy Managing Director, Corporate Investment Banking at Atijara Wafa Bank. And to my right, let me welcome Nathan Fabian, Director of Policy and Research, Principles for Responsible Investment. Emily Amin, Division Chief, Climate Change Division at the Inter-American Development Bank, Andaya Udgiri, member of the management board in charge of the strategic steering and business development at Mersin. So very good panel. We'd like to hear from them. I'm asking them to keep their remarks quite focused so that we can move and give you a chance to speak to them too. So to lead off, Dorsuma, the African Development Bank has announced a new deal for energy for Africa. It's a partnership-driven effort with the aspirational goal of achieving universal access to energy in Africa by 2025. You're leading on energy efficiency. Could you tell us a little bit more about the role of energy efficiency within this program and what some of the financing challenges are? Thank you. Yoran.
Thank you. Merci, madame. La question de l'énergie est actuellement la priorité de la Banque africaine de développement. Avant de répondre à votre question, je pense qu'il va falloir répondre à la question de savoir pourquoi l'énergie. Comme vous l'avez vous-même dit, l'Afrique est le continent dont l'accès à l'énergie est le plus faible au monde. Aujourd'hui, 645 millions d'Africains n'ont pas accès à l'électricité. Ça pose un problème. Et si vous prenez le taux d'accès par habitant, les estimations, encore une fois, donnent l'Afrique comme étant la région où l'accès par habitant est le plus faible. L'accès par habitant en Afrique est à environ 181 kWh par an, contre 6500 en Europe et 13000 aux États-Unis. Donc, c'est le New Deal on Energy for Africa, le nouveau pacte sur l'énergie pour l'Afrique que la Banque africaine de développement est en train de mettre en œuvre, est une réponse à ces défis liés à l'accès à l'électricité et à l'énergie de façon générale en Afrique. Et dans le cadre de la mise en œuvre de ce nouveau pacte sur l'énergie pour l'Afrique, nous avons, au niveau de la Banque africaine de développement, sous le leadership de notre nouveau président qui a pris fonction en septembre l'année dernière, nous avons mis sur pied une équipe qu'on appelle le Task Team, le Presidential Task Team, donc une équipe au niveau de la présidence même de la banque pour mettre en œuvre ce programme ambitieux sur le nouveau pacte sur l'énergie en Afrique. Et cette équipe, en ce moment, elle est structurée autour de 12 programmes structurants qu'on appelle des flagship programs. Il y en a 12. Et parmi ces flagship programs, il y en a un qui porte sur l'efficacité énergétique que moi, je dirige. Mais ce sont des programmes qui sont interreliés. Il n'y a pas que l'efficacité énergétique. C'est vrai que le problème de l'Afrique, en ce moment, c'est un problème d'accès à l'électricité, d'accès à l'énergie. Mais nous savons qu'en plus d'avoir un potentiel important en ressources d'énergie renouvelable, l'Afrique a également un potentiel en efficacité énergétique qui est très important. Parce qu'il ne s'agit pas simplement d'avoir accès à l'énergie, mais il est question également d'accès à l'énergie de façon efficace et en tenant compte des aspects liés au coût et à l'efficacité. Et nous savons que le potentiel en efficacité énergétique se trouve dans plusieurs secteurs en Afrique. Il y a par exemple le secteur industriel, les mines, il y a un potentiel important. Même au niveau du secteur énergétique, il y a un potentiel important au niveau des pertes dans le réseau de distribution d'électricité. Nous avons également un potentiel important dans le domaine agricole, où la façon de procéder à la fabrication des produits alimentaires dispose également un potentiel en matière d'efficacité énergétique. Mais donc, pour ne pas seulement s'arrêter au niveau de l'efficacité énergétique, je voudrais également mentionner les autres programmes qui sont importants. La transformation des services des sociétés d'électricité en Afrique, ça fait partie également de nos priorités. Le partenariat, à titre d'information, en matière de partenariat, je voudrais rappeler, vous l'avez déjà dit, la Banque africaine de développement, aujourd'hui, loge le Hub Afrique de l'initiative Sustainable Energy for All des Nations Unies. Donc, le Hub Afrique se trouve chez nous. Nous accueillons également le secrétariat du African Energy Leaders Group, dont le secrétariat est assuré également par la Banque africaine de développement. Et aussi, la Banque africaine de développement a joué un rôle très important dans une initiative récente qui a été lancée à la COP21 à Paris l'année dernière, le African Renewable Energy Initiative. Aujourd'hui, la Banque africaine de développement loge l'unité de mise en œuvre de cette initiative. Et donc, c'est pour vous montrer que la banque est en train de jouer un rôle très important dans la transition énergétique à laquelle vous avez fait mention. Et pour nous, la transition énergétique, ce n'est pas seulement accroître l'accès de l'Afrique à l'énergie, mais également de s'assurer que les questions liées à l'efficacité énergétique soient également prises en compte. Parce que nous pensons que ce nouveau deal, ce New Deal on Energy, va jouer un rôle très important dans la mise en œuvre de l'accord de Paris, dans l'atteinte des objectifs de 2 degrés ou 1,5 degré. Pour l'Afrique, en tout cas, le New Deal aura un rôle important à jouer. Et cela va se faire en accord avec l'accord de Paris, mais également en accord avec l'objectif numéro 7 de développement des Nations Unies, l'objectif sur l'accès à l'énergie durable. Donc je voudrais m'arrêter là, mais c'est pour vous dire que nous avons des objectifs ambitieux. Et le New Deal, son objectif fondamental, c'est l'accès universel pour l'Afrique en 2025, comme vous l'avez souligné. C'est ambitieux, mais nous pensons que nous allons y arriver. Merci.
Thank you. Very important to hear about the energy efficiency opportunities that span the whole sector of energy as well as into the industrial sectors, and also to be partnering with you to support access in Africa through sustainable energy for all. Shigeru, you're working in Africa, JICA is. Could you tell us a little bit about how JICA is bringing together the public-private sector, what it's doing on the planning side, and how this is helping with the transformation? Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. So I would like to respond from JICA's standpoint as a development partner on a government-to-government basis. I think most of the panelists are responding from a financial aspect. I would like that because JICA has two wings. The former is financial institution, and the latter is a technical corporation. So I would like to discuss from the latter part, technical corporation, with particular focus on planning. When we discuss about energy transition in Africa, it should be about not only quality, but also quantity. It should be about expanding African power system with cleaner energy, because there have been the situation that there is a severe power shortage, and also we should also take into account that there is a rapid power demand growth. According to United Nations statistics, population in Africa will grow by 4.7 billion towards 2030 within 15-year framework. This is the critically different feature from the developed countries, which are pursuing the replacement of the old existing carbon-intensive energy sources to the cleaner ones. So there are many critical barriers to the extension of the power system in Africa by cleaner energy, but I would like to highlight two. The first barrier is the big size of African continent and scattered distribution of the population. The installed capacity of individual countries or each grid system are rather small, sometimes less than 1,000 megawatts, and it is technically difficult for such small grid alone to embrace large power plant, which can enjoy the advantage of the scale. We should also note that such small grids are not flexible, so that they have limitation of introducing in non-dispatchable type of renewable energy without any additional efforts. The second is a lack of reliable data and also coordinated plan, which guide sequential investment or for the power facilities such as transmission, distribution, and power generation. So regarding how development partners like JICA can join efforts with public and private sectors, I'd like to explain our approaches. Yeah. If you could take a look at the slide. So this is JICA's recent alignment of our programs and also project to the cross-national initiative Southern African Power Pool. Last year, we have launched a special study in order to formulate our strategies. We recognize that the supporting SAP is very meaningful for achieving the Sustainable Development Goal 7, which is universal access. For example, promoting of SAP development will contribute to the development of regional and country electricity market in more structured, transparent, and foreseeable manner. We may note that power pool may solve the uneven distribution of primary sources. For example, hydropower, I hope you can see. So there are blue dots, many of them. So they are hydro sites. There are abundant and numerous hydro potential sites. However, most of them are untapped at this moment because of the lack of the connection. International connectors and domestic backbone transmission system may connect large potential of such hydro to the people in the countries or places where such potential is not available. The power pool benefits the developer side as well. The power pool may allow the developers to access the larger size of the customers. To meet the demand from such customers, developers may construct larger size of the power plant. In this way, investors may enjoy the economies of the scale. It will also create more opportunity for introduction of cleaner energy, including solar, as it may enhance grid flexibility by expanding the size of the grid. However, this broad picture of SAP must be broken down into actual planning and implementation. It shouldn't stay as a picture or drawing. So we are conducting national level master plan in Tanzania, Mozambique, and Angola at this moment. So these studies may not only foster the power development plan in the respective country, but also promote coordination amongst sub-countries, which is a prerequisite for the success of cross-national initiative. So this master plan is expected to reflect, including IMTC and latest and energy and resource policies, and to be open to the public once it is completed. We do hope that those plans will be fully utilized by potential investors to validate their interested projects. Along this line, we will also provide feasibility studies and, if necessary, financing, especially for transmission and distribution. I would like to point out that investment on transmission and distribution system should be before investment of the power generation, as a matter of law. And the investment in these systems are less attractive to public sectors compared to the generation. Therefore, so we have much challenges in the transmission and the distribution system. Thank you.
Thank you. I think very important points about translating visions into strategic investment plans, and also about the need to have coordination and tackle some of those smaller projects. Maybe this is a very good segue to you, Andrew. You're leading Deutsche Bank's asset management sustainable investment team, managing $1.8 billion of assets for funds in renewables, energy efficiency, microfinance, and a number of other things. And you've recently been very successful with a new funding application from the Green Climate Fund focused on sustainable energy. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about these funds, what they're going to support and how they tackle some of the challenges in financing on the ground.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jane. You're correct, we've been successful in having our funding proposal accepted by the Green Climate Fund. We've been successful in having our funding proposal accepted by the Green Climate Fund in Korea a couple of weeks ago. We have a lot of work to do to translate that into success on the ground, but it follows a model and a track record that we've built over many years now in the public-private partnership fund space. And I think it's an important point that the private sector is trying to engage, and it's trying to engage by understanding the problems, bringing its experience from its previous investment activity to those problems. And I think it's also trying to crowd private finance in. That's very much the model we've worked with a number of key partners, including the European Investment Bank and the KfW. Our experience with the KfW as their investment manager for the ATIF Fund, the Africa Agriculture and Trade Finance Fund, has been that we've spent 5 years understanding and building a pipeline of investments and executing investments in a difficult space. Agriculture in Africa is not easy, and we've learned a huge amount from that process. And I think one of the things that we've learned from that is the need to make sure that the type of investments we're focused on are effective for the people we're lending the money to and sometimes lending the money through and onwards. But also that the investors understand that there's no quick fix here. We're not suddenly going to produce miraculous outcomes and returns. It's extremely intense. And I'm fortunate that the asset management company that I work for has that view and wants to be involved in that. So I think what we've learned with ARTIF over the last 5 years is the importance of having local presence, of having partners locally, and engaging both with local institutions, government institutions, as well as finance institutions on the ground around what we can achieve and how to source opportunities. But we've also learned that many of the ACID rules of successful investing apply, particularly the need to structure, the need to document, the need to due diligence. And therefore, one of the issues that we've come across time and time again is how ready some of the investment opportunities are for that investment. And I think technical assistance is a critical element in aiding that and helping it mature. So I think that that's, you know, very useful from our point of view as background. What I would say as well is that I believe that obviously the scale of the problems, which has been discussed at many previous conferences, demands private capital being brought in. And therefore, on the debt side in particular, and in countries where typically we're bringing investors, sometimes for the first time, but there are emerging markets that are regarded as higher risk, and market risk as well as local risk, that it's extremely important to have that first loss capital tranche, whether that be from a European development institution backed by a sovereign, or whether that being from the GCF. But it's also important to have a clear vision of what you're trying to achieve with that capital. And I think for the fund proposal that we put forward to the Green Climate Fund in Korea, it was very clear that what we wanted to do was actually execute on what we believe is a critical vision for the future of cleaner energy. And we believe this globally in developed markets, developing markets equally, which is that distributed generation plays a critical role. And by distributed generation, we mean putting renewables in at source of need so that you're immediately alleviating the need for transmission infrastructure. And I'm not saying that transmission infrastructure is not needed, simply that there is huge gaps around that where distributed generation can play a role. We're also quite close to the development of battery technology as it would apply to static storage for renewables. And obviously that's expensive at the moment, but we think that's kind of where solar was about 10 years ago. And therefore the cost curve collapse that's coming is going to be aggressive. And that's going to be great for people who want distributed generation with backup and therefore usage for the non-light hours. So from that point of view, you know, we think that model is core for Africa. We think that there's a huge need for distributed generation, for remote power going into villages, homesteads, where they're way off grid at the moment. And interestingly enough, the economics actually work very well in a country like America as well, where transmission is 40% of the cost of power for many communities that are somewhere off grid. But obviously in Africa, we're talking about supplying power for the first time. And then secondly, we believe that the microgrid, the need for microgrids, linking this up and making it more efficient again is critical. And thirdly, with our fund proposal, we were also targeting large static diesel generation, fossil heavy generation that we want to initially hybrid and then ultimately take completely clean. We can't and will never have a team big enough to go and source all of that. We have to partner up in country, and we're confident after our experience with ARTIF and before that with GCPF that we can do that successfully. We do have presence on the ground in Africa, and that has to increase with this. UGIAP, the fund name which we've given this, Universal Green Energy Access Plan for Africa, will be a much larger fund, partly because we've secured a much larger amount of risk first loss capital from the GCF, and partly because our track record in the private-public partnership fund space is mature enough now that our investors are comfortable and are looking to get involved and engaged with outcomes based on the Paris Agreement. So I'll leave it there. It's just it's an interesting addition to what we've already heard around scale and around the need to be efficient on a grid as well as a microgrid.
Thank you, Andrew. You raised key points about sourcing projects, having a local presence, first loss capital, and sort of helping with the readiness. Yusuf, you're working locally at Ajari Wafa Bank. Can you tell us whether you have, how you've addressed those needs yourself, what you see as some of the challenges, and where your pipeline is going? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jane. I'm very honored to be part of this panel with such distinguished guests. I also seize this opportunity to thank CFC for this high-level event. So I'd like to share with you the experience we have as Tijari of a Bank, a Pan-African bank, as we are present now in 16 countries in Africa. And as you have mentioned before, I think that we have really a huge paradox now occurring in our continent. One is that you have large renewable resources that we see on the ground, whether solar, geothermal, wind, hydro, biofuels. You have also dynamic stats materializing in a doubling of the sub-Saharan economy since 2000. The size of the economy has reached $2.7 trillion US dollars. And at the same time, the growing demand for energy is plus 45%. But in the same time, as it has been mentioned, there is this huge gap since 7 Africans out of 10 don't have access to electricity. It makes 600 million inhabitants in our continent. It means that in countries like Sudan or Liberia, only 2 to 3% of the inhabitants have access to electricity. In Nigeria, one of the largest economies in our continent, only 3,000 megawatts are available. It means that they need still 10,000 more megawatts to connect 100 million Nigerians. So the paradox is there, and the challenge is quite strong. All the more so, we have growing demand. 1 billion people additional need to be connected to the grid by 2040. So what we see is that there are many projects that are occurring, whether in Western, Central, or Eastern Africa. You have wind projects. The Tarfaya project is in Morocco, for instance, is a very a significant one. You have projects in Kenya, you have biofuels in Nigeria, you have geothermal energy, you have hydro in Ethiopia, but we need acceleration in order to close the gap. And what we see on the ground as a bank is that there are both financial, technical barriers to financing, but also there are some kind of institutional barriers that need to be addressed. Among the financial barriers, what we see is globally overall, there is a problem concerning the size of the banking balance sheets that are relatively too small in those countries in order to address the challenge and to finance large projects. So there is a limitation in terms of size. We have also some constraints on the regulatory ratios that make long-term landing difficult. And often what we see is that many countries, you can't land on maturities exceeding 7 to 10 years. So it's problematic when you address large projects that need financing on 18 years. And this is a huge challenge. The other challenge is that you need also financial markets, deep financial markets, to have complementary resources that will pour into project finance. And there is a lack of fiscal incentives in order to encourage long-term savings. So there are initiatives, but we need acceleration in order to make financial markets emerge, asset management, institutional investment emerge, and be complementary with the banking resources in order to pour into the project finance, and to have also more financial autonomy of the continent along with the international financing. So we see these financial barriers that need to be addressed, but there are also institutional ones that we see, and maybe some issues regarding the governance, the IPP framework, that need to be implemented globally, because this is key in order to attract private investment, in order to transfer the investment costs on the private investors. If you take the Grand Dam barrage in Ethiopia, it's $4.8 billion. It's financed on the budget of the government. It's 15% of the GDP, so it's a huge burden on the budget of the government. So IPP are schemes that need to be encouraged as well. But you have also successful experiences that need to be shared, because there is not one Africa. We see many successes in countries transitioning positively, and Morocco is one very good example where we have the chance to have a very strong vision in the sector. We have also a solid framework in terms of IPP that has been developed over 20 years now, so there is an experience curve that has been implemented. We have 8,000 megawatts at 96% electrification rate, and a very interesting track record in terms of renewable energy, both wind, solar, and hydro in Morocco. That has been made possible by a mature banking market, able to land above $1 billion on the single project regarding the concentration ratio, and to land on more than 18 years maturity. So the change is possible, and what the initiative should be taken by banks and private investors as well on the ground. So if you take this example in our contribution as a bank, both in Morocco and sub-Saharan Africa, is to encourage those private project finance schemes along with the private investors and in discussion, interaction with the government. If you take an example, over the five last years, we have been financing or underfinancing $1.5 billion today. Half of that amount goes to renewable energy, and the other half to waste management, sanitation, and property. We had also some interesting steps and initiatives in order to promote not only banking loans, but also to attract equity. We are now currently launching an efficiency energy fund, which is called the Fonds d'efficacité énergétique, which is a fund which will be capitalized up to 50 million euro, and which aims to invest into SMEs, industrial companies, in order to implement savings in terms of energy in all those companies. So this is an initiative that is going on. We have been also very honored to give support and advise our Moroccan solar energy into the first green bond. Mr. Bakouri, the chairman of Mazen, has made the announcement this morning. We have been very honored to take part, to be part of this initiative, being advisor and global ranger of this first emission. So many, many initiatives need to be taken, and the sharing of experience and the constant dialogue with the governments is key in order to implement those IPP projects that are occurring on the ground.
Thank you. I've heard a very common thread about having a clear vision across all of our speakers, and having also some realism about how far we can go, some of the financial barriers within the market that you've talked about. But Morocco, strong success story that could lend some lessons or share some experiences for others across the continent. Daya, you're working at Mazen, strong leader in the solar sector. Also, we've had the announcement of the green bond this morning. Could you tell us a little bit about the projects that you'll be investing in that are linked to the green bond, a little bit about where you see some of the opportunities and challenges for renewable across the continent? Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I mean, opportunities in renewable are definitely very high. I think on a worldwide basis, and even at a much higher level in Africa. Definitely accessing to financing and to the right financing could help a lot in having all these projects being developed. Now, as we're saying that access to financing is key, actually it's not the hardest thing to do, because for this we pretty much know that, I mean, this is money language, and money language is pretty much very well spoken on a worldwide basis and on common basis. You just need to have the right risk allocation, you just need to have the right experience that would definitely lead you to the right financials, and that hopefully if you have the right management, you can easily access to financing. But then the harder thing is to access to cheap financing. And we can only develop at much accelerated pace climate finance-based project if we can access to cheap financing. Because definitely those projects help do something very good and correct for the world, and it needs to be supported. So the thing we've been really trying to focus on since day one at Mazen is to see, okay, how can we do to access cheap financing? Of course, with all the first steps being put together, first step was to try to really maximize all the grants that was available in the market. European Union were very supportive on that basis. We had also many German entities that were very, very supportive in providing grants. And then, so this is like level one, step one. Step two is to see if there was any dedicated funds that provide specific funding to the kind of projects we were developing. And luckily we had the Clean Technology Fund that actually is being financed by a large number of countries and provides financing on 40 years basis with 0.25%, which is really, it's even more than grants. So we've been like, this is the stage two. And then how can we access to concessional financing that is being provided by development and the Bank of Development? Because we do believe that the Developing Bank and IFIs have a very, very important role to play in the development of the countries and development of the projects which are in relation with climate finance. So we were, I think, pretty lucky in 2009, because this climate change item was very, very interesting, I would say, for them. And so what we have done here is that we've tried to mobilize all the concessional financing that was available through many IFIs with the government support. And actually we have packaged all the financing that we were able to raise, and we have unlended it to the developers, meaning that we have played the role of lender and of a bank. To be able to benefit from the concessional funding that is only provided to supported government entities. And actually with all this, we were able to reduce the price per kilowatt hour for the first solar project by more than 30%. So definitely accessing cheap financing can help you develop at a much more accelerated base and on a much larger base this kind of project. For the last projects we are developing, which are more focused on photovoltaic ones, we indeed actually mobilized funds from KfW and also from the Moroccan market through the green bond that was announced this morning. We were really happy to be able to achieve that, thanks to the trust and of the Moroccan investors, and we were able to raise more than 1 billion dirhams. That's really interesting rates, as we had a 10 basis points of risk premium on 18 years maturity, which really here again is very much helpful to deliver the cheapest electricity. And I'm going to try not to be that long, but actually all in all, I think that if we want to help transition of energy to be as clean as possible, we need to find a way to help access to cheap financing. And cheap financing can be delivered by many entities, of which procedures can be much more flexible and much more supportive of the overall objectives. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe taking a little bit more of an international perspective, Amélie, your team are launching an investment study with Mercer at the COP this week. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how it helps with this energy transition?
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Jane. We are launching a report, and in fact, it's being launched today. It's so new that I don't even have the link in my website, but if anyone wants the full report, you can contact me afterwards. But just to give you a background about why we decided to undertake this study, we wanted to understand how all these trillions of dollars or euros, trillions of dirhams, can be leveraged into sustainable infrastructure and to be done in the most affordable way, i.e. what types of projects do investors see as attractive. We know that institutional investors are really not going into infrastructure in a big way, in a couple of countries, Australia, I think Canada, but really in the emerging markets, very, very limited experience. And yet, we know, delivering on the Paris Agreement, delivering on the Sustainable Development Goals, and of course the Addis Ababa billions to trillions, requires us to really bring those investors into sustainable infrastructure in the developing world, particularly in Africa, given the huge, huge infrastructure needs. So we launched this report. We have three main components. This is just the very first output of what will be a bigger, more comprehensive report around what investors perceive as good investments, good projects, relatively minimized. But before doing so, we thought it was important to understand what the international ecosystem looks like in terms of support for investment in sustainable infrastructure. So we mapped out a number of initiatives. Now, the good news, as you see, over the last 10 years, there's been a real significant increase in the number of initiatives working to promote sustainable infrastructure compared to normal infrastructure, the green being sustainable. We looked at 30 initiatives. Just to emphasize, we only focused on initiatives that were exclusively focused on infrastructure, whether sustainable or not, and looking to mobilize investment into particularly institutional investors. So there are a lot of other initiatives which you've heard about today, many of those that we did not look at. And we just looked at those dedicated to this exclusively and not just as part of their activity. Now, we then we identified the four key barriers to investment in sustainable infrastructure, which have been documented through various studies in recent times. And those four barriers being lack of viable funding models, inadequate risk-adjusted returns, high development transaction costs, lack of transparent project pipelines, which align development plans with climate change or the sustainable development goals, and unfavorable and uncertain policy and regulatory frameworks. So we then took those 30 initiatives, we categorized those into three main areas: influencers of policy, so providing research, convening to influence policy, mobilizers, looking to actually mobilize investments into projects, so looking at funds, I think, such as the ones we've heard about, and tool providers, in particular, how to integrate sustainability requirements into investments and the various tools needed to enable that. And identified how many were focused on the main barriers. As you can see, these mini pie charts reflect the dark blue showing where there is a very strong focus on that particular barrier, and then where there's just a little triangle where there's probably less focus. So I guess what stands out, where there may be some gaps, would be in terms of how to influence the development of more transparent project pipelines, and in terms of tool providers, particularly with regard to policy and regulatory frameworks. Now, for us as a multilateral development bank, that is very interesting because, of course, it is our role to work with others to help generate these project pipelines. We also then looked at the initiatives in terms of impact. Now, this was a qualitative assessment. So, you know, the size of the different pieces of pie, you know, really reflect what we consider reflects impact with regard to the type of influence each initiative was having. And so you can see a lot of focus on investor mindset, much less on public policy, and also the investment process, particularly the process by which sustainability is integrated into the investment process. And finally, so not talking through the whole report, but just wanted to give what really we find as our main conclusion as the four C's. And, you know, being able to say this for the first time in Casablanca, it's like the four C's of Casablanca, which I was very happy about. But we see four main areas as being important moving forward. We see it's important to clarify principles, and in particular, what do we mean by sustainability? The report highlights that there are many, many definitions. Even within our own institution, the IDB, people have very different definitions of sustainable infrastructure. So there really is importance to clarify that, and we believe to come up with coherency around standards. The second being to commit to sustainability. So these initiatives, as I said, some are focused on infrastructure only, some exclusively sustainable. We believe all now must focus on sustainable infrastructure. We know the well below 2 degree target requires all infrastructure is sustainable moving forward. The other C, we see an important role for convening of conveners. So we really see of these 30 initiatives and probably some others that there needs to be more coherency between these different initiatives, more interaction and collaboration, very importantly. So the fourth C, to provide through the convening and through collaboration, we believe, and this is what we hope to also confirm in the later stages of the report, but we do believe that these initiatives will be more effective at providing the supportive signals that investors are seeking, provide greater transparency and longer term transparency. The Paris Agreement does provide a signal, but given the urgency for accelerating investment, moving from business as usual into sustainable infrastructure, we see that having collaborative and coherency between these initiatives is really necessary moving forward.
Thank you. Definitely interesting to hear that you raised the question about investor mindsets and process. Since our next speaker, Nathan, is working on the principles for responsible investment, you've been particularly working on the policy issues and the barriers that prevent financial markets from functioning sustainably. Could you tell us a little bit about what investors are looking for? What do they need to make the transition that we've all been talking about?
Yes, thank you. Thank you to everyone in the audience today. I'll just say that PRI, as a partner to this event, is delighted to support it, and congratulations to everyone who have carried forward this very important idea of a climate finance day, and may there be many more. So we are the $60 trillion that was identified earlier. There are $60 trillion worth of investment within the PRI signatory group. Now, it's important to note, although we can be positive about the amount of capital, that $60 trillion is not reinvested every year. A lot of that is already invested somewhere. You might say there are roughly about $4 trillion worth of new inflows across that $60 trillion each year. We know we need around about an average of $1 trillion per year into this new clean energy. So the numbers still work, but the 60 might be a little bit deceiving. Now, there are four ways that investors respond, and I'll talk you through those in a moment, but I would just like to recognize some of the French investors, Caisse de Dépôt, Mirova, AXA, and ERAF, and others in the room today, who have been at the vanguard or at the front of this change in institutional investment practice over the last 12 months. For their work last year and for their work this year, and I recognise my colleagues from the French CIF here as well, who has worked so effectively in that community. So the four actions and some of the current activities that investors are taking. The first thing is that we are owners of companies. And around about a third of that 60 trillion goes directly into company ownership. Now, just a quick segue. The discussion on this panel so far has been focused on project finance and a little bit on direct infrastructure. Okay. The amount of investment through this channel in the 60 trillion is well below 1% of portfolios, and that's not to say it can't grow, but we just need to realize that these big pools of capital invest through other channels, and so other activities in terms of the energy transition are also important. So we're owners of companies, and one of the ways that we try and support the energy transition is by being active owners of those companies and encouraging them to align their capital management plans and their strategies with a 2-degree transition. This happens with company resolutions on disclosure, but it also happens with direct meetings between investors and boards to get them to come up with a capital allocation strategy for below 2 degrees. Now, that conversation is much easier at Total than it is at Exxon. In fact, Exxon doesn't even pick up the phone when we call. But some of the energy companies do, and they are developing transition plans that might help them avoid being a Kodak. To use the example of Anthony Hobley earlier, some might make the transition, and so some of the capital will go to those markets. Secondly, of course, we're allocators of capital. And I said less than 1% was in sustainable green infrastructure. But nonetheless, there are allocations growing in that area. And of course, the other thing investors are doing is withdrawing capital from the companies that they don't think can transition. That's why global coal stock prices are down by 90%. Pardon me. Of course, there is a gas boom as well, or there was, but the energy transition policy being one of the drivers has influenced stock prices and capital has been withdrawn. Third way we do it. We do it by influencing the perception of risk in the market. And investors have made a great effort to assess their own exposure to emissions and to disclose that information to the market and to signal that they see it as a risk. So the Montreal Carbon Pledge has been mentioned today, 120 investors who assessed their exposure to emissions and published it just last year. And of course we have the Bloomberg Carney Task Force, which will release the report soon, it was reported earlier. But you can expect that there will be multiples of the 120 investors around the world who are assessing their exposure, making it transparent, and changing the perception of risk around emissions in the market. This is important. It sounds like it might be a bit of a market framework that doesn't directly allocate capital to project finance in Africa, but it still matters because it changes the price of capital and the availability. So look out for that one in the next few months. And of course, we work with policymakers. And I would draw your attention to African government representatives in the room, to market regulators, to the work of the Chinese in the G20 in the last few months. Of course, if you develop your own framework, market framework, to encourage green finance, it will look different to the Chinese. They've got so many channels and such authority, centralized authority to implement. But the point is, they took a strategic approach across their markets and institutions to try and encourage green capital flows. And so I would recommend this as a signalling approach to private markets that the regulators and authorities in countries are taking these issues seriously and are trying to say we're open for business. This should not be underestimated. So despite these important things that investors are doing, there's still a gap. Okay, we know we haven't got enough capital, it's too expensive, it's not flowing into the right areas, infrastructure and project finance. And perhaps worse than that, if we've got around $300 billion a year that is flowing, very little of that is going to Africa and Latin America. We know a lot of it's going into China, North Asia, and of course Europe and North America, but that's not going to solve the problems that we've got here. Or in fact, take advantage of the opportunity to provide energy that is needed. Now, when we're thinking about markets, we shouldn't assume that they're perfectly rational, okay? We need to make up for the lack of carbon pricing with a range of other measures that change the risk-reward equation, but we need to think about other aspects of how the markets work. And this is what PRI is doing. And I can relay some new ideas. Announcement's a bit too grand a word, but I can relay some new ideas, some new things we're going to be taking on very soon. So some of the issues, we know we've got problems with packaging of products, distribution of investment products, investor capacity to understand, and of course, a range of risk mitigation issues. So, one thing that we're involved with is the Green Infrastructure Investment Coalition. It is bringing issuers of green infrastructure to developed country markets. We brought 20 Indian banks to London a few months ago. We're bringing 20 Brazilian banks to London in December. African operators, if you have good institutions who can issue debt over green products, this would be something that would be open to you to do, and we're keen to have that conversation. Secondly, PRI has 1,500 signatories. We've gone through and identified the 100 most likely infrastructure investors in the world to allocate to emerging market green infrastructure. We have communicated with them, and we will be using this group to promote product, new investment opportunities in emerging markets for green infrastructure. And finally, we have established a panel of investors who will provide feedback to development finance institutions and development banks, and also green banks, on product design and de-risking instruments that will draw institutional capital into these areas. So they're new things. I'm delighted to relay them to you today, and they signal how we're trying to work on some of the people side and the process side of the investment markets. Finally, if there are regulators and market operators here who do want to do more on investor duties, do want to do more on their green finance plans, I would offer PRI as a large group of international investors who will work with you to refine those plans and signal to the investment community that you are open for business. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Nathan. Important points around the policy, the ability to influence risk perceptions, but also some practical options to move forward, which is great. Do we have time for a couple of questions?
Yes, maybe 5 minutes, then we're going to have the synthesis of the day.
So maybe we could take two or three questions from the audience, if there are any.
Let's go for the first one. Who has any question for our panelists? Please, sir.
Hello. Can we speak about a normal energy mix in case of development energy in Africa? Because if you say the normal energy mix that should be in the European way of doing things, 30% like this. But here we are speaking about something that is completely different in Africa. So can we think about something else than a normal mix of energy, about 30% or something like this?
Because Would you want to introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, my name is Green Hisham. I'm working for the Maroc-Lié, the Moroccan CSD.
Okay, you mean do we have the ability to create our own mix and our own model on the continent?
Yeah, completely.
Okay.
It should be completely different.
Because
different.
Can you, ladies and gentlemen, shift and think as Africans?
I'll just make one comment on it, and I don't want to stop anybody else doing so either. But I agree with you. I do, and I think you can actually compare it to the issue of landlines versus mobile and the stage where you can adopt latest technology rather than go backwards and just try and copy. And that's why I think that the idea of distributed generation, where you align the need with the ability to produce that power, is critical. And I think that, in a way, Africa lends itself exactly to that. You've got large amounts of land, you've got large gaps between population centers, you've got relatively low incomes, you've got much lower demand at this stage. But most of all, you need a decentralized system where the ownership is local, where effectively the power generation is delivered directly to the users, and the users actually can sense the ownership and the need to utilize it efficiently and to grow it if they need to over time. I think that linkage is something that that has caused a huge amount of barriers to adoption of sensible climate policies globally, because people don't have any sense of ownership for the power that comes to them, and therefore the pollution it creates. It just arrives. And seeing it on a distributed generation basis is great. I think if you listen to Elon Musk describing the Gigafactory, I think he's just done it in the new movie that Leonardo DiCaprio has done, the Before the Flood. He looks at it as well. He says the same thing. Put the batteries in next to the distributed generation, you'll change the energy mix, and you empower local communities, and you take the power away from very large corporations and large government departments. So I think that's a great model, and it's financeable. In my opinion, it's financeable.
Over on the left.
Yes. Thank you very much. Olivier Rousseau from the French Pension Reserve Fund. I am one of the large French investors that was not mentioned by Nathan, but that's okay. My question is on the political risk. When it comes to infrastructure investment in Africa, the issue of political risk is very often mentioned as the one that makes that people, at the end of the day, don't do it. In particular, as I understand it, there has been, and there still is, a big debate within the Norwegian Oil Fund about going into infrastructure, and the nays about the concept of doing infrastructure in Africa are all centered on too much political risk. How can we get past this problem? Of course, diversification, but probably there's something more needed to make people jump into the fray. Thank you.
I have to start with an apology, don't I, for my response. Forgive me. So I think the places that have, the ways we've seen this work reasonably well is where there an intermediary has stepped in with some knowledge of the local market and some financial risk protection. And so the development finance institutions have a critical role to play, and the development banks have a critical role to play. Investors have not yet really woken up to the amount of opportunity that exists in co-investment vehicles with these institutions. They understand political risk, they're often prepared to take the risk on their own balance sheet and provide some certainty over returns. And so we investors in the room, we need to spend more time looking at this potential deal flow and encourage the development banks to use as much of their capital as possible for leveraging, de-risking, and addressing political risk. And there is plenty of examples of success here. And we've heard from some of the colleagues today from the development finance world.
Yeah, Emily? Just to add to that, I think, you know, as development finance institutions, exactly that. We have to recognize, I think particularly though, as we're moving now out of a period where all infrastructure was a sovereign guaranteed type of investment, into the need to really mobilize private sector and the importance of public-private partnerships in that context, such as Mazen has been very successful as. And I think it is a case of trying to use a range of different resources, whether that is concessional resource in some cases. But I think when we focus more on political risk, as you say, I think we also have, as DFIs, a very important role in to really work more upstream. So part of what we want to do, and we hope the findings of this Mercer report will help us engage better with governments, with ministries of finance planning, in their as they're starting to develop their PPPs, their public-private partnerships, looking at their procurement systems, looking and doing this very upstream work that can really help build much greater awareness within the governments that there's a certain number of risks they really can work to minimize. I would call that probably more policy risk myself, but I think it's the line between policy and political risk, it becomes quite blurred in this context. And you know, of course, then there's other political risks that maybe you might cover through a sort of, like through MIGA, for example, the multilateral guarantee.
Josuma, you had something you wish to say?
Thank you. I think if we only look at political risk, we end up in a situation where we cannot invest in countries like African countries. I think to date we have some instruments to mitigate risk.
And there is an opportunity here to use instruments like guarantees to mitigate the risk. As we used to say, there is no zero risk. So we need to address the risk. And if you have, you need to do business in those countries, including those risks into our investment plans is very important. That's first. Second, I think it's important also that at government level, we create, or national governments in Africa create the enabling environment for, attracting investments. This is still missing, because if you look at the energy investment so far in Africa, most of it comes from the public sector. Still, private sector has some problem to come in because of those kind of risks, be it political or policy related or financial risk. So far, we know that only about 10 to 11% of investment come from private sector because of those risks. So we need to make sure that to provide the necessary enabling environment and also the instrument, the financial instrument, to provide like sort of guarantees to make sure that private investors can have the necessary confidence to come and invest in Africa. I want also to cover the last point on the energy mix. I think in the Africa's perspective, for us in Africa, I think we are talking about transition. Transition means we move gradually to a non-renewable use of energy to renewable energy. So use of non-renewable resources in Africa, like oil, coal, gas, is still important. I was, we were discussing recently with some colleagues, and someone was asking, if you only focus on renewable resources, how are we going to do with all of those huge opportunities in terms of non-renewable that Africa has? Some countries have a lot of oil. How are they going to use those resources if you only ask them to do renewable? So I think energy mix in Africa means we need to take into consideration the potential in specific countries and regions. So for me, it's important that we bring the energy mix at local and national level to make sure that we don't, we come to a country where there is a lot of opportunity in terms of non-renewable. How can we help them to use clean technologies to improve, the quality or to sustainably use those non-renewable resources? But if also there is an opportunity in terms of non-renewable, how can we make sure that at the same time we can also assist those countries to exploit or to use these renewable energy opportunity that they have? So I think energy mix for me is very important if it happens at local and national level, where we know the actual potential in those countries in terms of renewable and non-renewable resources. Thank you.
Okay, last two very short questions and very short answers, please.
Speak about cheap finance. I didn't understand what are you referring when you speak about cheap finance, because my understanding is that finance is always expensive. So what do you mean by cheap finance?
Is it a matter of cost? And what is the idea of having a kind of low cost or cheap finance? What could it be?
When you have debt with interest rates below 2%, this is cheap finance.
Yeah, it doesn't cost.
I mean, yeah, it's really about, at the end of it, it's about cost. So when you're having either debt or either equity investors that request for returns that are much lower than commercial basis, then this is what we call cheap financing.
Okay, it's, okay, thank you. Last one. Please.
Oui, bonjour, Balrod Sarah, je suis journaliste aux Inspirations Eco. Moi, j'ai juste une petite question. Depuis ce matin, on parle d'agriculture, d'environnement, et j'ai pas entendu parler de l'industrie. Est-ce qu'aujourd'hui, avec la finance verte, on peut espérer avoir une industrie lourde comme celle qui s'est développée et qui a permis le développement justement de l'Occident, qui peut être mise en place au niveau de l'Afrique? Merci.
Josuma, would you like to respond to that?
Merci pour cette question. Moi, je pense que vous avez parfaitement raison. Si on prend l'exemple des pays industrialisés, je ne vais pas dire développés, on les appelle des pays industrialisés parce qu'ils se sont développés sur la base de l'industrie. Or, pour l'Afrique, aujourd'hui, l'industrie occupe une place très faible dans nos économies, en raison certainement des choix économiques qui ont été faits à une certaine période de temps par les gouvernements. Aujourd'hui, par exemple, pour le cas de la Banque africaine de développement, avec les cinq nouvelles visions stratégiques que nous avons pour l'Afrique, l'industrie occupe une place importante. Avec notre nouveau président, nous avons cinq grandes priorités et l'une d'elles s'appelle industrialiser l'Afrique. Tout simplement parce que pendant longtemps, l'industrie n'a pas été au centre du développement des pays africains. Et à travers ces nouvelles visions que nous avons pour l'Afrique, nous voulons ramener l'industrie au centre du débat. Parce qu'il est certain que sans l'industrie, nous ne parlons pas parler d'un véritable développement en Afrique. Même si on investit dans l'agriculture, à un certain moment, l'agriculture a besoin de l'industrie. Nous, si nous investissons dans d'autres secteurs, tels que les secteurs miniers, l'exploitation des mines, à l'époque, ça se faisait avec des technologies qui n'étaient pas durables. Mais aujourd'hui, de plus en plus, nous avons des technologies qui nous permettent de nous industrialiser en tenant compte des principes du développement durable. Donc je crois qu'avec l'accord de Paris, qui reconnaît explicitement le droit au développement, tout simplement, et qui reconnaît également la nécessité pour l'Afrique d'utiliser des sources dont elle dispose, qu'elles soient renouvelables ou non renouvelables, nous avons la possibilité de contribuer réellement à l'industrialisation de l'Afrique. Et l'opportunité s'offre également à travers les objectifs du développement durable que nous avons, qui n'exclut aucun pays de faire des choix dans le domaine de l'industrialisation. À un certain moment, on avait peur d'utiliser le mot industrialisation à cause de l'utilisation des énergies fossiles. Mais aujourd'hui, nous savons que il y a une possibilité variée d'utiliser aussi bien les énergies fossiles à travers des méthodes plus durables et également d'utiliser des énergies nouvelles et renouvelables qui peuvent contribuer également à la protection de l'environnement. Donc je suis parfaitement d'accord avec vous et nous, au niveau de la Banque africaine de développement, nous travaillons réellement à ramener l'industrie au centre du développement des pays africains. Merci.
Thank you.
Yusuf, you can add something.
Just maybe two comments about that, concerning the way energy, renewable, can help maybe industry in our countries. I'll take the example in Morocco of the law of 1309 law, which is a law that enables private producers to sell directly energy to industrial clients under the form of wind energy. And this law, in the framework of this law, private producers sell directly and the transportation of energy is made by the public electricity company. And the price is less than the public price. It makes savings possible for the industrial clients. And in the framework of this law, more than 500 megawatts have already been developed in Morocco and enabling substantial energy savings in the industrial sector in Morocco and helping competitiveness of the sector. I would make a late statement about the equity part, the missing equity that's often observed in energy. And our initiative in the Energy Efficiency Fund is also contributed to those energy savings that are made in the form of direct investments within the industry, replacing some equipments by saving energy equipments. And this is also contributive to helping competitiveness of the industry. So just two comments about that. Thank you.
Okay, and yes, you want to add something else, please?
I just wanted to highlight as well, though, because we do have a tracking methodology for what we count as climate finance. So I don't know if you're at the event tomorrow. Yeah, that will probably be the focus of discussion, and we'll get into quite a bit of detail around that.
Yes, and the event is starting at 9 here in the hotel, and there may be some hundreds of people. And this is the event organized by the International Development Finance Club, and people coming from different parts of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I have one last question. I can't refuse that because we had a wonderful day, and if it can give some more content, why not?
Thank you very much. So, Hamid Tofiki, CEO, CDG Capital. I have just a question for you. Don't you think for climate finance in the South to be sustainable, it need to be rooted into local capital market or regional capital market.
That sounded like a statement, which I would agree with. So it will work better for international investors if there are reliable counterparties, local investors. So that's why it's important, the upstream work is important. We need to develop the banking systems, we need to develop the expertise of the local institutional investors. I was encouraged by the pension regulator from Nigeria earlier. So yes, this is an absolutely critical part of the puzzle. It's not just simply a case of shoveling a load of cash from one side of the world to the other. So thank you for your remark.
And also just to add to that, absolutely, and we had our project last year that was approved at the Green Climate Fund, an energy efficiency securitization project, which is in Mexico currently, but will be expanded. And critically, that's about securitization in the domestic markets to build awareness, because that is going to be essential for many reasons, but also currency risk is also an additional risk that is can be minimized through that as well.
So I know we're over time, so I will do my best to give some quick highlights, just run through this. We talked about the importance of vision, clarity on the vision, a strong vision, and the importance of defining sustainability, the importance of the role of decentralized energy, as well as on-grid, and the role of IPPs, and the challenge in sourcing a pipeline, but the importance of having a local counterpart. Panelists highlighted the importance of being realistic in terms of what we can deliver and how far we can go and the returns that we can get. And also we had a long discussion about cheap financing. Financing is there. It's not necessarily going to project finance. It's not necessarily going to all of the geographies we need it to go. And we heard a lot about the market challenges in the banking sector. But also some solutions, a call for policy, call for flexibility, a call for investors to engage, to be transparent in terms of how they're investing and change some of the perceptions of risk in these markets. And then lastly, it was very encouraging to hear some practical solutions, investor roundtables, some successes that we could take from Morocco, learn from, share elsewhere. So I think on that note, I would really like to thank the panel for their time, very stimulating points and discussion, and also for the audience for very probing questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane, and thank you to your panelists.